Welcome, everybody, to another lesson of English for International Communication. Well, communication in English requires the understanding of what some professors have been saying here. Lots of elements related to language, lots of elements related to meanings, different expressions we use, and of course, elements related to the relationship between speakers and the language, different contexts, as you have analyzed here, in different moments, contexts like business, context if you want to be a taxi driver, among other, let's say, fields that you have worked with other professors. In today's lesson, we're going to focus on some of the differences, some important elements related to what kind of language you want to use, what kind of variant you want to use in English. There are so many variants in English, but in today's lesson, we will only focus on English in America and English in the United Kingdom. So let's take a look at this slide and analyze today's main objective. So that is what we're going to do. We're going to try to understand the major differences between these two variants of English. So there are different, let's say, variants, taking into account the different levels of the language that we're going to be analyzing. But before we go into details, I think it would be important to go a little bit over the history of English. Let's then take a look at the slide and analyze the diasporas. How did English spread? This is like a quick overview. There was a first diaspora where there were migrations to different places like North America, Australia, New Zealand, and South Africa, and a second diaspora, a second spreading to places like, or continents like Asia and Africa when, the time when they were colonized. Another important element that we should take into account is the following. Some historical, social, and political elements, and some of the names that, or some of the, let's say, yeah, names, excuse me, for the repetition that we use when we consider English. Well, we have English as a first language, and the number of people who speak this language. According to Crystal, there you have some of the numbers on the screen. Then you have English. This is like another classification as an institutionalized second language. You also have English as a foreign language, such is the case of Cuba, where we speak English. This denomination of English. And finally, English as a lingua franca. What kind of English do you use? The English the language used most of the time in different events, in different exchanges with other professionals. Okay, well, as I was telling you, in today's lesson, we're going to have the possibility to analyze the differences between all the levels of the language in the two variants. We will have the possibility to analyze different sounds. That will be the phonological level, among other elements. In the lexical level, different words, different expression, the spelling of these words. At the syntactic level, that is, what sentences do you use, what elements can be combined depending on each of the variants. And finally, the textual level, so important these days, where the pragmatic element is so important, the relationship between people, the context, etc. Now, just to begin our lesson, we're going to have our first video. And this is just a video where you're going to get familiar with elements that might be different from one variant to another. Now, in the video where you're going to watch, you have English in the American variant, English in the UK variant, and English in the Australian variant. We're not going to analyze the Australian variant today. That is going to be for future lessons. So the task is very simple. Let's take a look at the slide. Well, you're going to watch a video and write words or sentences you hear in the correct side of the chart. What levels of the language are involved? Do they talk about sounds that are different? Different words, maybe differences in spelling, or maybe different sentences, different communicative functions that occur at the sentence level. So remember, only focus on British or American English. This time, it will not be necessary that you write down any elements about Australian English. Is that clear? Well, it's very simple. Write British to the one side, American on the other side. And if you can, try to provide their correspondences. Okay, so I hope you're ready and listen to it for the first time. Come on, go ahead. Watch the video.
Hello, my name's Amelia. Today, we're going to look at the different types of English in the world. You may think that they're all the same. After all, it's the same language. But actually, there are quite a few differences. The most obvious one is pronunciation. For example, can you tell where these characters are from? The United States, Britain, or Australia? Hi, how you doing? Hi, how are you? G'day, how are you going? It isn't just pronunciation that's different, it's also spelling. British English sometimes uses extra letters. Here are a few examples. British, favorite. US, favorite. British, color. US, color. Sometimes the British use different letter order too. British, center. US, center. But the major difference is vocabulary. Sometimes, even though people from the United States, Britain, and Australia all speak English, they can still get very confused when talking to each other because they use different words for the same thing. Listen to these. If you walk down the footpath past the servo, my unit's on the left. If you walk down the pavement past the petrol station, my flat's on the left. If you walk down the sidewalk past the gas station, my apartment's on the left. You probably prefer one type of English to another, depending on what you've been taught or what you're used to listening to. That's perfectly okay. There's no right or wrong type of English. One is not better than any other. Next time you're listening to the telly, TV, or watching a film, movie, try to listen out for the different accents and the vocabulary they use to see if you can guess where the people come from. As far as Cambridge English writing and speaking exams are concerned, you can use the standard English you prefer. Cambridge English exams are international, so it doesn't matter which English accent you have or what vocabulary you use. Just remember to be consistent. Stick to one type and don't mix them up. Good luck. Thanks for watching.
So here we are, English for international communication. It doesn't matter what accent you have. It's just being consistent, as she said. I hope you didn't have a hard time understanding the Australian accent. It's very hard, but that is for future lessons. Now, let's check which of the words or expressions you were able to write. Ready? Okay, so there we have some of the ways we can greet in British English. Hi, how are you? And then the American English. Hi, how are you doing? Of course, you can use both variants in both expressions in the two variants. There were differences in regards to the way we write those words, in regards to the spelling, as she explained. There you have the word favorite, the O and the U, and then in the American variant where the U is not present. The same happens with the words color. In the case of the word center, or centre, as it would be in British English, you have a change order, like the R, E at the end of the word. And in American English, you're going to have E, R. It happens to other words, but we're going to analyze that later in the lesson. That is the most important intention in today's lesson. Petrol station and gas station. The flat and the apartment, the telly and the TV. So this is only to get familiar with some of the words, some of the expressions, some of the sounds that we're going to learn in today's lesson. So now I invite you all to work with me and to go through on the different levels of the language, right? So right now we're going to analyze each level of the language step by step. Remember, from the smallest part, that is the sound. Many sounds, the word. Then from the word to different combinations, a sentence. And finally, the users of this sentence, the context. Little by little, we're going to try to understand that in today's lesson. Are you ready? Let's see. The first level would be, as you can see on the screen, the phonological level. What sounds? Where's the word stress? Then we begin with the first differences between the two variants. Now, as you can see on the board, on the screen, you have in color blue where the stress would go in the two variants. I'm going to try to repeat in each of the variants. I'm going to start with the British variant and later with the American one. Let's begin with the British variant. Adult, ballet, brochure, garage, vaccine, advertisement, hospitable. It's in American English now. Adult, play, brochure, garage, vaccine, advertisement, and hospitable. So there you go. You can, take a look at these differences. Of course, these are not the only words that are different in terms of word stress. There are others. We're just trying to model in today's lesson some of these examples. Let's then go to the other slide. There are also differences in the way we pronounce certain letters. For instance, that letter I in British English would be pronounced like agile, fertile, hostile, mobile, versatile. In American English, that will be read the following way, with E. Agile, fertile, hostile, mobile, and versatile. So remember, the main difference here is in the British variant with the diphthong I, and in the American version is pronounced as sound E. It's very simple, just a vowel. Next, let's see. The sound of letter A, right? We're going to see how we pronounce that in the following words. And let's begin with the British variant. Bath, class, chance, laugh, ask, after, can't, example. In the American variant, bath, class, chance, laugh, ask, after, can't, an example. I think it would be a great idea to take a look at the camera. Yo creo que mejor si miramos a la cámara y si es posible que le acerquen la cámara al rostro del profesor para tratar de entender estos sonidos mejor. Iríamos en el caso del inglés británico, si fuéramos a decir, por ejemplo, la palabra baño, alguna de las palabras las voy a decir, y vamos a ver cómo pondríamos la posición de la boca. Voy en inglés británico. Ready? Bath, class, chance, laugh, ask, after. Now, in American English, let's see what happens. Bath, class, chance, laugh, example. ¿Y alguien se daría cuenta de esa diferencia? En inglés británico, el maxilo inferior de la boca iría hacia abajo. Mientras que en el inglés americano, abrimos más la boca y es una combinación intermedia entre la A y la E. A, E, E, bath. Inglés británico, A. Okay? Good. Let's go on. The sound of R in some words. It is a tendency in British English not to pronounce the R. So what we do is we prolong the preceding letter. For example, hard, were, ear, pure, more, bar. In American English, we do pronounce it. Hard, were, ear, pure, more, air, and bar. In British English, hard. La lengua casi que ni se mueve, se queda abajo, no se pronuncia, sino que se prolonga el sonido anterior. Hard, hard, were, were. Did you get that? Good, let's go on. Okay, now let's see the pronunciation of this ending. In the British variant, we have, let's say the letter E is pronounced in these examples as I, as the diphthong, as we have seen before. Civilization, organization, authorization, and globalization. Whereas in American English we have civilization, organization, authorization, and globalization. So I hope you are understanding the main differences between each of these two variants. Another important sound that is very peculiar in each of the variants is the sound of the letter T. And in the case of British English, we do pronounce it T. Better, water, and of course I'm not pronouncing the R in those words. Again, better, water, hated, bottom, native, artificial, notice. That is in British English. We pronounce that T. Now, in American English, it is very common to produce that T as a D. For example, better. It's like the R. Es como la R del español en palabras como pero, para. Vamos de nuevo. Better, water, hated, bottom, native, artificial, and notice. All right, do you notice the difference? T, ra, ra. Let's continue. The letter T before an N is sometimes omitted in American English. In British English, it is pronounced. Let's see in the case of the British variant. 20, Toronto, International, Pentagon, and Center. In American English, the T is dropped. You don't pronounce it. 20, Toronto, International, Pentagon, and Center. Are you following me? I hope you are. I'm enjoying this. Are you? Let's go on. Let's see what happens with the diphthong O. In British English, there is a tendency to produce the sound O in, let's say, a weaker way. O in American English, O in British English, in a sound we call in phonetics, chwa. It's a very weak sound. O. O. For example, hello. Home. Don't. No. Oh. No. And go. You see? All right. I hope you're having time. All right, I'm just a little bit thrilled. Let's see the American variant. Hello. Home, don't, no, I hope you're repeating, oh, no, go. A In British English, remember, again, if we say hello, hello, good job. In American English, hello, oh, hello. Okay, I hope you're learning not only to speak, but also to decode information. It is important to understand these main differences when you're listening to each of the variants. Now, I think it is time to do an exercise. I'm going to give you some time to get familiar with some sentences that I will try to pronounce in American and in British English. So take some time to get familiar with these sentences. We're going to have three on this slide and three more on the other one. So your task is very simple. You have to identify if the following sentences contain words in American or British English. Just take some seconds. All right. I hope you're ready for the pronunciation of the first three sentences. Remember, British or American English. Number one, I'm going to do my best. I have been practicing a lot. Number one, have you parked the car yet? Yes, it's in the garage. I'm going to repeat that. Have you parked the car yet? Yes, it's in the garage. Have you parked the car yet? Yes, it's in the garage. British? American? What do you think? Number two. How did you like Toronto? I loved it. People are very hospitable. How did you like Toronto? I loved it. People are very hospitable. Number three. After I did the homework, I took a bath. After I did the homework, I took a bath. Yes, I know you're understanding. Let's take a look at the three other sentences. All right, so there I go for number four. I didn't have the chance to see that movie. Some people said it was better than the first part. I didn't have the chance to see that movie. People said it was better than the first part. Number five. You need authorization to enter there. You need authorization to enter there. Number six. I don't know the answer to that question. I don't know the answer to that question. So I did my best. I hope you were able to identify if it was British or American English. Let's analyze the answers. All right. I have highlighted the main differences of, let's say, the sounds that we have produced. What are the differences? Well, in the first one, you have British English. Have you parked the car yet? The sound ah is very common in British English. Have you parked the car yet? Yes, it's in the garage. The word stress is different. British English. Number two, how did you like Toronto? Toronto. Remember, we dropped that T in that combination. I loved it. People are very hospitable. And word stress is different here too. In number three, if you were able to decode and identify the word R, not pronounced in the word after. After I did the homework, I took a bath. After I did the homework, I took a bath. Homework, right? Remember that weak sound we just studied. Let's see the rest of the sentences. In number four, it's in American English. I didn't have the chance to see that movie. People said it was better, ¿verdad? Like DDD, ¿verdad? Or like la R del español, a la cual hacíamos alusión anteriormente. La R de pero, de para, ¿Cómo se puede analizar en la palabra better? First part. Y la boca bien abierta en los sonidos. Have, chance. I didn't have the chance to see that movie. People said it was better than the first part. Have, chance. Okay. Number five. You need authorization. That letter is pronounced with the diphthong. That is the way they use it in British English. Authorization. Enter there. You need authorization to enter there. There. Right? Prolonging the element is important here. And finally, I don't know. I'm going to say it again. I don't know the answer to that question. It's in British English. Oh, I don't know the answer to that question. Good. So I hope we are, let's say, learning, and we are, let's say, understanding the main difference that we have in this level, right? Phonological level. What sounds are different? What, where is the pronunciation? Where does the word stress go? Any differences in the diphthong, in the way we pronounce? Yes, there are so many. Very important to speak and very important to understand what somebody else is saying. Let's then move to the other level of the language. The lexical level. Words that we use that might be different in the two variants. Let's take a look at some of the first differences. There are differences in spelling. As we analyzed at the beginning, the combination R-E are altered in each of the variants. In the British English variant, R-E, whereas American English, E-R. Same happens with the word theater or theater. A remarkable difference is how they write in the ending eyes in words like realize or recognize, how they tend or how they most of the time use the S, while in American English they write that with a Z. Realize, recognize. Another difference is the ending of the word travel, of the verb travel in the past. There you have it. They double that L in the English, word. Another example you saw in the video was the combination of OU in words like favorite, color, and neighbor in British English. And in American English, you drop that U. It is not necessary. So there you have these words. We saw them at the beginning. Maybe you want to take some notes. So remember, altering the words R-E, S, then Z. And very remarkable, the combination of O-U, O-O in American English. Okay, so lexical level. Let's continue. There are different words to describe the same reality. It is very common in American English and in British English that they have a lot of differences in elements related to street transportation in general, car parts. I've heard stories from people whose cars broke down in America, and they were from Great Britain, and they had a hard time because they were not understood, because every part of the car, most of them, is different in British English and in American English. So we have the word tube, right? A means of transportation. It goes under the tube or the subway. What is that? El metro. Muy bien. Now, another means of transportation will be the lorry. Lorry in American English, in British English, and truck in American English. A truck. People use it to move furniture. What is it? Camión. Muy bien. Now, you have different words like the boot or the trunk, right? That is the part of the car that is in the back part. What is it? The trunk, el maletero. You also have the bonnet and the hood. That will be the frontal part where all the machines are. All right. Now, there are differences also in the way they name flat and apartment. Well, it is evident. You understand it because you have it. It's very similar to Spanish in the case of American English. Elements in regards to sports, such as the skipping rope, the jump rope, that would be used to what? To jump when you do exercises. Sería como lo que nosotros decimos en español, la Suiza. Muy importante para la realización de ejercicio, right? So, in some cases, you have skipping rope and the jump rope. Now, another element that you use for swimming would be the diving board or the dive board. Sería el trampolín. Muy bien. Now, there are also differences between, let's say, pavement and sidewalk. And that is something that pedestrians use to walk on, to walk along. Pedestrians, los peatones lo utilizan para caminar. ¿Qué sería? Muy bien. La acera. Film in British English and movie in American English. Oh, seasons. We have the word autumn and we also have the word fall. Okay, maybe you want to take some time to copy one of these differences. Let me give you some seconds. This is only the first part. We have more to come, so take your time. So, I hope you had time to copy this first part. Remember, what words do we use in what variant? All right, so remember, most of the time they have a hard time understanding car parts, a lot of things related to traffic, and there are also other differences. Let's take a look at the slide and see the second part of this list. Okay, we have trousers for pants in American English. Now, we need to be careful because when we say pants in, let's say, British English, we mean underwear. And this might be a problem because maybe you're talking about somebody's, you're telling them that they have beautiful pants and they might think that you're talking about something else. You're talking about an underwear and that might be disrespectful. We're going to talk about that later. Now, the petrol station and the gas station. Football in British English and soccer in American English. football in American English can be something else. American football. Primary school, elementary school, crisps, or chips. Estas dos palabras que se refieren a las papitas que vienen dentro de, la, de las bolsas. Ahora, chips and French fries, those are the potatoes we peel at home, we prepare at home, and they also have different ways of being called. Now, in British English, they have a fizzy drink, fizzy, like it has gas in it, and soda in American English. Then you have a lift. So nice, when you have a lift, you don't have to go up the stairs. An elevator in American English, no need for translation here. A lift, an elevator. All right, so I'm gonna give you some seconds so you can copy these, this second part of words to describe the same element in our reality. Take your time, please. Okay, so we continue on the lexical level. Words, what words do we use? Now, sometimes in this level, we have different phrases, different expressions. You can find this expression called in the bibliography like collocations, phrases, idioms, phrasal verbs. And there are also differences between the American and the British English. Let's take a look at the following slide, please. So some actions and idiomatic phrases between, in each of the variants. Well, to queue up in American English, to stand in line. I hope you know what that is. We do that a lot in Cuba. We stand in line. Hacer cola. Fíjense, ese queue up y a manera de, digamos, para que usted entienda un poco algo que se llama, como estamos trabajando en el nivel etimológico, en el nivel, digamos, lexical, desde el punto de vista etimológico, esa palabra viene del francés, de la palabra de francés que se pronunciaría que, pero bueno, la que nos interesa hoy es la del inglés británico. O sea, es influencia directa del francés y se pronuncia queue, to queue up. In American English, stand in line. Now, we also have different expressions like a skeleton in the cupboard, a skeleton in the closet. That is just an example of some, idioms we can use in each of the variants. A skeleton in the cupboard is a scandal that is kept secret. Algo que usted no quiere que las personas sepan, algo que usted no quiere que salga, que se haga público. Es como, en fin, un esqueleto en el closet, ¿no? Usted no quiere que lo vean. Pero fíjense como cada variante utiliza diferentes maneras, ¿no?, para referirse a esa realidad. Cupboard and closet. Now, in British English, people, when they want to continue having, like, luck, to be lucky, they touch wood. Y esta se parece a la del español. Tocar madera, ¿no? Cuando uno quiere que las cosas le salgan bien, dice, déjame tocar madera, porque realmente deseo que los planes sigan adelante. In American English, people knock on wood. Las personas que hacen inglés americano golpean en la madera. O sea, que la variante británica está más, o sea, se parece más a la variante de nosotros en el español. You touch wood and you knock on wood. You want things to go good. If you believe in that, okay, knock on wood. Some people do that because that is a superstition. Now, when people talk about having an idea of something in British English, it is common to say, I haven't got a clue. Haven't got. We're going to see that it's more common to use this combination of words in British English, haven't got, while in American English they say don't have a clue. Oh, let's see what happens when we want to find a room. In British English they let rooms, whereas in American English they rent rooms. Okay, so I'm going to give you some time so that you can copy some of these expressions. Le voy a dar algunos minuticos, como hicimos en las diapositivas anteriores, para que usted pueda copiar algunas de estas frases utilizadas en cada una de las variantes. Por favor, tomen tiempo. Well, I hope you don't feel overwhelmed. I know a lot of words. It takes a lot of practice. It takes a lot of memory training. So, my bad, right? It's not my intention in today's lesson to give you a lot of vocabulary, but just to give you some tips on how to be aware that there are certain differences between American and British English. So, I hope your memory is doing well, because now we're going to do an exercise. I hope you don't take a look at the notes, because in the next exercise, you're going to match words in American English and words in British English. Let's do the next exercise. Estamos listos para el siguiente ejercicio. Vamos a ver. Let's see the slide. Well, in exercise number 3, I will give you the possibility to match the words in column A with British words, British expressions, and in column B with American English. So what you need to do is look for the correspondent word or verb action in the variant, in the other variant. So please copy, and there you have some of the words that you have seen so far. Ahora les voy a dar tiempo para que copien y hagan el ejercicio. So did you do that? That was difficult, I know. Learning new words require memory training. And most of the time, for different reasons, we are in Cuba very exposed to the American variant of English. We watch a lot of movies in American English. But from now on, this is like an invitation to watch British English too, right? It is important to practice and to learn from different cultures. So how did you do that? Was it difficult? Do you remember the words? Okay, let's see the answers. There you have the word pavement with sidewalk, flat, a flat with the word apartment, lorry, truck, tube, the subway, hood, the bonnet. Ahorita no se lo dije, es el capó del carro, la parte delante. Autumn, fall, football, soccer. To let, when you talk about apartments, you rent an apartment. And to queue up, to stand in line. So how was that? I hope that was easy, right? It is an exercise just to recognize some of these elements. Remember, it's just the first day. We're going to learn all these vocabulary as we practice more and more. Okay, so I think it is time to do another activity related to, let's say, identifying new words, but this time we're going to do an exercise in which they are more contextualized. Context is very important. So for that reason, we're going to try to analyze these words in a specific context. So what are we going to do? Let's take a look at the slide. In this exercise, we're going to analyze the conversation and write the words corresponding to each variant. Let me give you some context, because I told you that context is important. This is a conversation between two friends. Both of them are from Great Britain, but one of them just came back from the United States. So he's making use of his, let's say, words of the new vocabulary that he has learned, and he's trying to play or make his friends aware that he knows new words, right, in American English. "Hey, nice pants." And the woman says, "Excuse me? I said nice pants." "You can't see my pants, can you?" Do you remember that? Pants? Underwear. So it's not underwear what he means. "Of course I can. How can you see my pants?" "They are on your legs." Empezamos. A ver, yo creo que sería bueno empezar desde la primera oración. Vamos de nuevo. "Hey, nice pants." "Excuse me? I said nice pants. You can't see my pants, can you?" "Of course I can. How can you see my pants?" "They are on your legs." "Huh, you haven't been to America recently, have you?" Fíjense cómo él le está celebrando que tiene los pantalones. Pero pants, ¿qué significaba? Underwear. Es una parte íntima, es una ropa íntima. Y no es lo que realmente ella entendería, porque en inglés británico, pants significa esa parte íntima, ¿no?, que utilizan las damas. Por lo tanto, no es lo que realmente ella está entendiendo. Por eso lo dice, "How can you see my pants?" ¿Cómo usted puede ver esa parte íntima de mi cuerpo? Pero bueno, lo que realmente le quiere decir es, le está celebrando, le está diciendo que son sus pantalones, ¿no?, a lo que está haciendo alusión. Seguimos entonces. "Oh, I actually just got back from LA. That's Los Angeles, by the way." He's showing off. Se está como que luciendo porque fue a Los Ángeles. Y entonces le está queriendo decir a la amiga que se sabe nuevas palabras. Y le dice, "I know. Yeah, I picked up, I learned some of the American words, and now I forget which ones to use. So confusing." And the woman says, "We call these trousers in Britain." "Of course we do. You know, there are so many things. That is exactly a completely different language sometimes." "Really?" "Yeah. Would you like a crisp?" Y ella le está ofreciendo una papita, de esas de las que vienen en las bolsitas, que vienen ya prefabricadas, y le está brindando. "Would you like a crisp?" Vamos a ver su respuesta. "Crisps? muestra como asombro. Crisps. In the States, they are chips. Oh, so if I want to order our chips in America, what do I ask for? El problema es que en los Estados Unidos, chips, o sea, en Inglaterra, chips serían las papas, ¿verdad? Que nosotros pelamos, que preparamos en la casa, lo que en Estados Unidos sería French fries. Y bueno, la mujer se sigue, la amiga, ¿no? Se sigue como mostrando interesada en lo que él está diciendo. And you know what that is? Don't you? Está, en este caso, se está, él está haciendo referencia a algo que supuestamente ella tiene en la mano. A fizzy drink. Y él le dice, that's a soda. Mm. You know the lift over there? Yeah. Y seguimos. That's an elevator. Oh, really? You know, in the States, you don't go to watch a film. Y la mujer sabía, dice, esa sí me la sé. Dice, you watch a movie. Exactly. And you don't walk on the pavement. You walk on the sidewalk. I know that one. You got it. I watched a lot of films. Oops. Movies. Oops. Right? She made a mistake, so she used this interjection. Oops. Movies. All right. So, to summarize, there are some differences in this conversation between the man and the woman. There you go. You have trousers for pants, crisps, chips. It's kind of confusing because chips in British English would be what for Americans would be French fries. A fizzy drink, a soda, a lift, an elevator, a film will be a movie, and the pavement will be the sidewalk. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed that. Now, very briefly, let's analyze some of the differences. And remember, this is the first lesson in which we're going to work on the differences. We're going to have more time for that, but very briefly, I think it would be, let's say, important to focus on some of the differences in the syntactic level. For example, some meanings are expressed differently in each of the variants. When you talk about birthdays, when you express a recent past, sorry, when you talk about birthdays, the order of the day and the month is the main difference you find in the two, let's say, variants of English. Expressing a recent past, lo que en español diríamos la acción o la expresión acabar de hacer algo, en inglés británico es más utilizado el present perfect, el antepresente del español. So Tina has just come back from her trip. Ella acaba de llegar de ese viaje. Mientras que en inglés americano es más común la variante con el pasado. I just ate dinner with my family. All right, this is just an example of, let's say, the two variants. When you talk about possessions, we have seen that. The variant with got, she's got. With have, I have an apartment on Willow Street. And the way you make suggestions or recommendations. So, just take some seconds to copy that. Les voy a dar algunos segunditos, porque después, de manera muy breve, vamos a ver algunas de las diferencias a nivel cultural. So we're moving from the sound to the word, to the combination of words, to those words in a sentence. So remember all the three levels that we have worked on in today's lesson. There are also cultural elements, but that is something I, let's say, would suggest that we study in our next lesson. To summarize, in today's lesson, we have been able to understand some of the differences between American and British English in all the levels of the system of the language. And it doesn't mean that we're going to stop there, because it is important to understand other cultural differences that you have studied with the other colleagues, with the other professors. So I hope you enjoy the lesson. I hope you continue working on the pronunciation of sounds, learning the new words, combining, let's say, different expressions in American or in British English. And this is just an invitation. From now on, I hope you, let's say, not only listen to American movies, British movies too, understand all these differences in context. Thank you very much for sharing this lesson with me, and I will see you next time. Bye-bye.